أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه أما بعد. In this halaqa, inshallah, we explain hadith number 16 in al-ahadith al-nawawiyya عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رجلا جاء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال أوصني قال لا تغضب فردد مرارا قال لا تغضب رواه البخاري ومسلم. In this hadith, this is one of the greatest ahadith that talks about the etiquettes of how one should conduct themselves as a Muslim, where Abi Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrates that a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said to the Prophet ﷺ, "Awsini," means that give me good advice, show me a good deed to do that will cause me to enter Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ gave him this advice with two words, قَالَ لَا تَغْضَبْ. He said, do not get angry. And we'll explain what that means, inshaAllah. فَرَدَّدَ مِرَارًا. This man, as if he's telling the Prophet ﷺ, yes, I heard that one, give me an advice. Or as he belittled this advice, or as he did not think that this advice is sufficient for him to enter paradise. فَرَدَّدَ مِرَارًا. So he continued to tell the Prophet ﷺ, أَوْصِنِي, أَوْصِنِي, أَوْصِنِي. And the Prophet ﷺ did not go beyond these two words, قَالَ لَا تَغْضَبْ. He said, do not get angry. Now we know from the seer that many of the Sahaba would come to the Prophet ﷺ and they would say, أَوْصِنِي, give me a good advice, show me a good deed, or show me a deed that will bring me close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or distance me from the anger and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or cause me to enter paradise. So we see that many of the Sahaba were very, very concerned about seeking, you know, a path of guidance upon the straight path, upon the path of Islam, and being very concerned about distancing themselves from the hellfire and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to enter in His paradise. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would give different people different advices. And some of the Mufassireen, they say that he did so because he was given specific advices to, or a specific advice to each individual based on their needs and their conditions, and based on the knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of that person and their traits. And some said, no, he would give this different advice to different people because different people, when they hear this advice, they will share it among themselves, and then this way they'll spread the advice and they spread the deen. So both of them indeed are acceptable and both of them are well needed. And it's something for us to, you know, remember that all of these advices that the Prophet ﷺ has given, we are more worthy of adopting these advices and also spreading them around. So in this hadith, the Prophet's advice is La Taghdab, and the Mufassireen, the interpreters of the hadith, they said, this advice means one of two things. La Taghdab means that when you get angry, because we all get angry, everybody gets angry, every human being, it's part of who we are, we get angry. When you get angry, do not execute, do not act upon your anger. Do not go to the extent of making your anger drive you for a reactionary measure that will cause you to later regret what you said or what you've done. That's one explanation. The other explanation of لا تغضب means that do not put yourself in a situation or pursue means or ways or circumstances that will inevitably make you get angry. And if you get angry, then you will act upon this anger. And in general, people are of different, you know, four different types when it comes to anger. Some of which, سريع الغضب, بطيء الإفاقة, means that they get angry very quickly, anything which triggers them. And it takes them a long time, you know, to rid themselves of their anger and to come out of this condition. And that's, of course, unfortunately, that is the worst of people. And in fact, this trait is actually a trait of hypocrisy, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, because in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, when he talked about the traits of a hypocrite, in the fourth trait, he said, وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرٌ. When this person is in a dispute with another individual, they go to the extent that they will remain angry with them for a very long time, and they could act upon this anger and they could commit things that are malicious in nature and very damaging in nature. So these are the type of people that oftentimes you find that they are lonely, that they are secluded, that people are very edgy around them, and you find that they don't have hardly any friends. So this is the worst type. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. The second type is one who is sari' al-ghadab, sari' al-ifaqa. They get angry quickly. They're very emotional in nature, but they also come out of their state of anger quickly. So this person is of lesser, perhaps it's a form of tribulation, but this person, of course, of a lesser degree of, risk to be around, if you will. The third of which is a person who is bati al-ghadab, bati al-ifaqa. It takes them a long time to get angry, but however, unfortunately, it takes them also a long time to come out of their anger. And that's, of course, not a good trait. The first one, the first part of it is good, but the second one is not good. The best of the four is the last one, which is one who it takes them a long time, to get angry, but when they get angry, also they come out of this condition of anger very quickly. Alhamdulillah, this is a very good, quality to have. And in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ was addressing one of the Sahaba, and he said, in you, what is roughly translated, in you there are two traits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. Two traits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So the man said, what are they? He said, al-hilmu wal-anah. Al-hilm is really reacting or acting the right way upon a situation. For example, you're confronted with a circumstance or a situation or a condition or a person, and you take the time to make sure that you're acting in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah, that you're acting in accordance with the wisdom. For example, the Bedouin that came to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ was wearing a rough gown, and this thobe that the Prophet ﷺ was wearing, it was like harsh in nature. It's not a thobe that's made out of soft fabric. So this Arabi, this Bedouin, grabbed the Prophet ﷺ from his garment, and he yanked him so hard to the extent that it put a mark on his neck. And Anas ibn Malik is observing this, who was the servant and a scholar, who was the servant of the Prophet ﷺ and a student of the Prophet ﷺ. He was observing that, and he said the Prophet ﷺ, كَانَ لَا يَزِيدُ جَهْلُ الْجَاهِلِ عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا حِلْمًا. When one acted ignorantly with the Prophet ﷺ, it only increased him in hilm. And this is the quality that we're talking about, hilm, meaning that he did not react to the situation, he acted with wisdom. So here the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this Bedouin saying, أعطني من مال الله الذي عندك, give me from the money or the wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted you, it is not your wealth and it's not the wealth of your fathers. In other words, it's just an insult upon an insult upon physical attack. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he did, he smiled to his face, he invited him to his home, and he gave him from that wealth. So the Arabi was extremely impressed with the hilm, of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how he behaved. And he said, you are a man of good character. You are a man who is very generous, Kareem. He said, when you go out, say this to me in front of the Sahaba, because they are very upset with you and the way you behave. So this is the first quality, which is hilm, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. The second one is al-anah. Al-anah min al-ta'anni. Ta'anni means that you do not react quickly to a situation, you take your time. And this refers to matters of the dunya. We're not talking about matters of the hereafter. Because when we talk about matters of the hereafter, we don't hold back, we do not wait, we execute immediately as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to. In the Quran, as he says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. Hasten with your deeds. Pray your salah when the time first comes. Fast when Ramadan first comes. Fast the nawafil, do the extra acts of worship. So when it comes to the ibadah, we do not adopt this quality. We hasten towards the ibadah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the tongue of Musa alayhi salam, when he hastened to go meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, وَمَا أَعْجَلَكَ عَنْ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى. What had made you hasten by parting ways with your people, O Musa? قَالَ عَجِلْتُ إِلَيْكَ رَبِّي لِتَرْضَى. He said, oh my Lord, I've hastened toward you so you can be pleased with me. So when it comes to good deeds and acts of khair and acts of, ma'roof and acts of ibadat, obligatory and nawafil, we hasten towards that. But anah, in matters of the dunya, that we do not hasten. Why? Because we really do not know for certain the outcome of the action we're about to take. Be it a project, be it a business, be it an employment, be it whatever the case might be, buying a home, buying a vehicle. We do not hasten with that. We take our time and we consult and we do istikhara. And that is the quality that the Prophet ﷺ is talking about, means that consulting the experts and doing istikhara, seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the success, because He knows the unknown and we don't. So this is the second quality the Prophet ﷺ has praised in this man. Al-anah is that you take your time before you execute in matters of the dunya, so you do not come back and regret. You do not come back and regret. These two qualities, al-hilm wal-anah, meaning that a person is acting out of wisdom. A person is now qualified to act out of wisdom. Now, with respect to ghadab, and what some of, you know, the hadith tell us about ghadab, in another hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, when a man asked him, he said, Umar ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he asked the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Dullani ala amr, show me or give me advice or tell me about something that will protect me from the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ لَا تَغْضَبْ وَلَكَ الْجَنَّةِ. Do not get angry and paradise is yours. Do not get angry and paradise of yours, is yours. In the hadith also that is mentioned by Isa alayhi salam, Jesus peace be unto him. And we know that Isa alayhi salam lived at the time of Yahya, John, and Zechariah, who is the father of Yahya. So Isa alayhi salam is telling Yahya, I shall teach you beneficial knowledge. So Yahya said, okay, tell me. He said, do not get angry if someone insults you or mentions something that is not in you. In other words, they're criticizing you with something that is really untrue. He said, if someone does that, do not get angry. However, you know, say alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not afflict me with this, you know, bad trait. And if someone criticizes you with something that is in you, right, do not get angry because it is a trait that you've been reminded of. So seek istighfar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's never the case that somebody is going to condemn us or criticize us except in one or two conditions. It's either this bad trait is truly in us, and in this case, we say, alhamdulillah, that this person has reminded me of this trait so I can rid myself of it. And if this trait is not in us, then we say, alhamdulillah, that this trait is not in me, and this is a hasana that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent my way. So we see that there are many, many examples. And one last one we mention is that Luqman al-Hakim, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about his story in the Quran, and his ample advice to, you know, to his son, as he gives him, you know, many, many advices in Surah Luqman. Luqman al-Hakim tells his son, he said, if you want to take a friend, the first thing you want to do is to anger them. Do something to anger them. If they are fair to you, take them as a friend. And if they are unfair to you, then do not take them as a friend. If they are fair to you, take them as a friend. If they are not fair to you, then do not take them as a friend. Why? Because it is part of being friends is that we disclose information that are private, that are secret between friends. So in a moment of anger, you don't want this person to turn to be your worst enemy and then divulge all of this information and all these secrets that you entrusted in them. So this is indeed an advice that is, you know, that is worthy of considering. So of course the advices are many, but we'll shorten that just in the interest of time and to touch about some of the treatments that the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned when it comes to, you know, anger. In one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, anger is from Satan. Satan is a form of jinn. It's a form of creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created from the tip of a flame. And he said, Satan has been created from fire, and nothing extinguishes fire like water. فَإِذَا غَضِبْتَ فَتَوَضَّ. So if you get angry, go and perform your wudu, because the wudu will extinguish that heat. You know, and in this hadith, or actually more specifically, the Prophet ﷺ said, do you not see that your eyes turn red when you get angry and your face begins to buff up and swell? He said, this is because of the heat from, you know, that Satan is injecting inside of you. So go and perform wudu. Of course, a step before that is when one gets angry is to say what? أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. If they truly say it sincerely with the purity of intention, that now realizing that anger is from Satan and none can help them overcome that but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking His protection and say, oh Allah, I seek Your protection from the curse Satan, because now I'm in a state of anger. And then you go perform your wudu. Because wudu in and of itself is also a ibadah. That you are performing an ibadah that is going to cool you down. And then the Prophet ﷺ also another hadith says that if you are angry while you're standing up, sit down. And if the anger does not subside, lie down. Because the lesser you are in a form of preparedness to respond to that which angered you, the more likely you are going to practice hilm and anah. That you're not going to say anything that you're going to regret, and you're not going to do anything that, you know, is going to make you, you know, regret it later. What are some of the implications of anger, and what are some of the responsibilities that a person who gets angry will have to bear? Some of the implications that one could utter words, and as we know, when words exit, you cannot take them back. So you could insult someone, you could curse someone out. You could engage yourself in ghiba. Ghiba means saying something about a person in which they don't like. You could say statement of buhtan, means that fabricated lies against this person, because you're in a state of anger, you're not reasoning, you're not rationalizing, you just want to vent this anger. You could actually commit a murder. How is that? We all drive now, and we all heard about road rage. And subhanAllah, I was in a vehicle where the brother who was driving, and then another driver began to anger him and bother him on the road. The brother pulled to the side and stopped the vehicle. Not everybody can do this. Most people will immediately react, taking it as an offense that this person has done something to jeopardize my life and I have to retaliate. This is our nature. This is our nature. So adopting or remembering these two qualities, and somebody could say, I naturally just get quickly angry and so on and so forth. But also in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ وَإِنَّمَا الْحِلْمُ بِالتَّحَلُّمُ العلم, one says, I'm ignorant, I don't know. بِالتَّعَلُّمُ, you seek knowledge. You seek a path of knowledge. You're consistent, you have a program to follow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will teach you. وَإِنَّمَا الْحِلْمُ بِالتَّحَلُّمُ, saying that I cannot, you know, I'm just easily angered. I cannot practice patience. I cannot, you know, act the right way. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْحِلْمُ بِالتَّحَلُّمُ, by way of practicing. You may fail the first time, the second, the tenth, but after a while you will get it. You emulate someone who is Haleem, who has this trait in them. And then you begin to learn, and slowly you will see that it will come to you. So this brother, mashallah, la quwwata illa billah, pulled to the side of the road, and you can see he's angry and his face is red, but he did not want to pursue. And this is the second interpretation of the hadith. Do not pursue a situation that can inevitably make you angry and react upon that anger. So this is something we also learn from, is that if someone angered me on the road and I'm in a position to stop, I cannot avoid this person, I stop. If someone says something to me, I do not have to respond immediately. There is always time, there's always another time that I can reason about what had happened and then respond. So we can see that sometimes this road rage will end up in what? Somebody getting killed. And initially you could say, they deserve it. But when you calm down and you look at what you have done, that you just killed perhaps a father with young children, or a son, you know, that the parents now are no longer going to have them. Or perhaps now you just killed a woman driver that is the mother of young children. Or you could have killed children inside that vehicle. So you can see that we don't think much about what we do when we react immediately. But if we think about the consequences or the implications, we'll see that this is something that will help us and give us the ammunition to behave the right way. Similarly, words sometimes that emerge out of someone's mouth could end up in a divorce. Someone could be very angry with their wife and they will tell her you're divorced. In that moment of anger. Alhamdulillah, some people who have this, you know, very chronic condition of anger is that when they get angry, you know, they become in a state of ighlaq, as the Prophet ﷺ described the state, means that they really don't know what they're doing. They're now being hijacked by these emotions. They don't know what they're saying. They don't know what they're doing. And alhamdulillah, the Prophet ﷺ said about a condition like this, لا طلاق في إغلاق. There is no divorce. When one reaches that stage, again, we're not talking about just normal anger, normal people who get angry. So this cannot be used as an excuse for one who just gotten themselves used to being angry and they can say and do whatever they want and they come and say, I was in a state of ighlaq. No, there is no excuse there. You know, this person is readily identifiable that they really don't know what they're doing. And they could utter statements of kufr. One with one word, could enter Islam, and with one word could also exit Islam. So you can see these are implications, right, that are the direct result of anger. And if you go to a prison, you interview these murderers or those who've caused tremendous damage to, you know, physical or property damage or any of that, they did it in a moment of anger. And they have tremendous regrets now that they've landed themselves in a place perhaps for 5 years, 10 years or more. Only for a moment of anger. So they built their entire lives, they pursued constructive and a positive way of life, building their careers and building their families and building this and building that, and in a moment of anger, all of this came tumbling down. Wal-iyadu billah. So we can see the dangers of anger, and we can understand why the Prophet ﷺ did not go beyond these two words, by saying, La taghdab. The man who was given this advice later, according to the narrators, or some of the narrators, said, When I thought about it after a while, after I parted ways with the Prophet ﷺ, I thought about it, I realized that anger is the roots and the essence of every evil. Anger is the root and the essence of every evil. So here we can see how significant this sin is. We can see that this sin will, God forbid, land us in very, very difficult situations, could land us in a situation where we commit a murder, okay, or physical damage, or any type of damage to even our most precious people, most loved ones. To the extent that some people may beat their children, in a moment of anger, that they cause them tremendous damage, irreparable damage. And that could, we've seen this. Some people, even here in this country, with a claim to have freedom and democracy and understanding and education and all that, just look at the statistics of domestic violence. And look at the statistics of how many wives end up being killed, or being homeless, or being in a hospital, all of it because of a moment of anger. All of it because of a moment of anger. So we can begin to understand how dangerous, this anger is, and how worthy of adopting and accepting, the advice of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, of commanded us, لَا تَغْضَبْ وَلَكَ الْجَنَّةِ, do not get angry, and paradise is yours. Now we'll touch upon one last issue. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala does not create things in us arbitrarily. So anger is a natural trait of every human being. Does that mean that we should never ever get angry or act upon our anger in any situation, no matter what the condition is, no matter what the situation is? Of course, that is not the right understanding. I'll give you an example from the seer of the Prophet ﷺ. When a group of the Israelites came to the Prophet ﷺ and they said, tell us about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said in this hadith, he said, كان الله ولم يكن شيء. At one point, there was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was there, and there was nothing else. Now, not to take this hadith out of context, I'm just going to explain a little bit in it. وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ. His throne was upon the water. And it's not for us to drift to envision how that might look like, or what water it is, or any of that. So, in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking about the heavens and the earth. He's not talking about creation at large. Why? Because in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ is mentioning two types of creation. The throne, the arsh, and the water. The fact that the arsh was upon the water. So he's not talking about al-adam, where there was nothing in existence at all but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's talking about the creation of the heavens and the earth. Because the group from Yemen who came to ask him, to inquire about, the creation, among them there were some of the Israelites. So the Israelites said, well, tell us about the creation. So he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth and, on the first day and the second day, and created the mountains in the third, and created the heavens and the earth and so on and so forth, all the way on until Friday. He said, if you complete this statement or this creation, we'll believe you. They're referring to what? Saturday, the Sabbath. So they said, if you say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after completing this creation on Saturday, as they believe, and that's a corrupted aqidah, of course, ثُمَّ استراح, then he rested, we'll believe you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got up and he was very angry. And notice the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not get angry except when the sacredness and the sanctity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been violated. And this is a lesson for us, that if we hear any statements being falsely made about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or even made without knowledge, that we get angry. It arouses these emotions in us. It arouses these emotions in us. So here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, you could see the anger in his face. His face would turn red. His eyes would turn red. His face would swell. And he got up, and in one narration, he began to pace back and forth, back and forth. So he practiced hilm, and he practiced anah. He did not react, he did not say anything, he did not do anything. Jibreel alayhi salam descended with this ayah in Surah Qaf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ وَمَا مَسَّنَا بِاللُّغُوبِ. That we have created the heavens and the earth, and all that's in between, in 6 days. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was telling the Israelites, you know what he created on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and all the way to Friday, and then they asked about the Sabbath, did he rest? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبِ, means no tiredness, no fatigue has overcome us. And if no tiredness and no fatigue overcomes a person, you don't need to rest. So let alone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So of course they did not believe him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ. Be patient, stay put, steadfast on the deen, and let them with that which they say. So we can see here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has gotten angry for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's never gotten angry for himself. He's always gotten angry when the sanctity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been violated, when the sanctity of Islam has been violated. Similarly, when he was fighting in the battle of Hunayn, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes that battle in some details in the Quran, and many of his military, many of the Sahaba, they were overwhelmed by the enemy, they began to retreat. And he was the only one, perhaps with just a handful of the Sahaba around him. He was in a state of anger, and he was moving forward as everybody else was retreating. And he was saying, أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَا كَذِبْ أَنَا ابْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَا كَذِبْ أَنَا ابْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ. I am the Prophet of Allah. I am the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a lie. I am the son of Abd al-Muttalib, here referring to his grandfather. Why? Because his grandfather is the one who raised him. And he was fighting a people who knew his grandfather, who raised him. So he's telling him, I am the one that you know. I have grew up among you. But, you know, the point here is that the fact that the Prophet ﷺ is saying, you know, is getting angry, and he's moving forward fighting the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this moment, this type of anger is justified. So when we stand up for Islam, we stand up for the enemies of Islam, this is well-justified anger. However, it has to be gauged between two perimeters. Hilm and ana. It cannot be reactionary. We cannot replace the munkar, that which the sharia rejects, by a greater munkar. So if someone says something about Islam, we cannot go and kill them. You know, we cannot face a statement with, you know, an act of murder. We cannot destroy buildings. We cannot, you know, destroy property. We cannot do that. We have to act out of, you know, these two parameters, hilm and ana, that are guided by the sharia and guided by the way the Prophet ﷺ has taught us. This is Islam. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do. And in the Quran, I will conclude with this ayah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes ibadur rahman. These are like the very fine group that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes to his name, ar-Rahman, the slaves of ar-Rahman, the All Gracious. One of these qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْبِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. That those, when they get angry or they're placed in a position that makes them angry, they hold back their anger. They do not act upon it. They do not execute. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and those who often forgive for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who perfect their deen and perfect their character and perfect their attitude. Whoever conceals or holds back on their anger or controls their anger for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on Judgment Day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in front of everyone, from Adam alayhi salam all the way to the last person to live on the face of the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring him forth and he will say, choose from al-hur al-een, these beautiful women that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for paradise. He said, choose whatever you wish for concealing and holding and controlling your anger for my sake in this dunya. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the words of wisdom and follow the best of it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us and enable us to control our anger. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to instill the qualities of hilm and anah and patience in us. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.